heart if I forget you. Fire and a gun come from me tongue. Jerusalem, if I forget you. Let my right hand forget what it's supposed to do. In the ancient day, we will return with no delay. Picking up the bounty and the spoils on our way. We've been traveling from state to state, and them don't understand what they say. 3,000 years with no place to be, and them want me to give up my milk and honey. Don't you see? It's not.
Shalom and welcome to Voice of Judea Television, broadcasting live from Yerushalayim. I'm your host, Yekutiel Ben Yaakov. If you are sick and tired of the twisted anti-Israel bashing in the media, even in the Israeli media, then you're tuned to the right place. Once a week, Voice of Judea Television, broadcasting Torah truth in the spirit of the Jewish idea from the holy city of Yerushalayim. I'd like to first apologize to our viewers. I know that we have thousands of viewers, and we received hundreds of emails and phone calls over the recent weeks asking why the Voice of Judea was not updating our weekly broadcast that can be seen on VOJ TV. And the fact of the matter is that we did not have the equipment and other technical difficulties with our server, which made it absolutely impossible for us to broadcast. As you can see from the quality of this broadcast, we're not quite yet back up to our standard. We're not CNN, we're not ABC, but we do have the Torah truth that you will not hear anywhere else. Everyone is talking about the war in Lebanon. We hear the demands coming from all of the Jews in Israel. I mean, I'm sure there are some that aren't saying this, but all that we can hear is a demand for a commission of inquiry. Where did we go wrong? Why is it that the Israeli army that was able to defeat Arab armies in 6 days in 1967 and overcome the Syrian and Egyptian armies in 1973, why is it that this army was not able to squash the Hezbollah and teach them a lesson that they would never forget? What went wrong? And this is the question that everybody is asking in Israel and around the world. And there's an obvious answer here, and there's an important point that we all need to recognize. The IDF did win. The losers here are Prime Minister Olmert and Defense Minister Peretz and the Chief of Staff Chalutz. These are the losers in this war. They are the ones that refuse to unleash the IDF, the full force of the IDF, to once and for all destroy the Hezbollah and to strike at Iran and to strike at Syria. The patrons behind the Hezbollah, these are the culprits, the politicians, and the Chief of Staff who hesitated throughout the war, and they finally, hours before the ceasefire, finally, at that point, they allowed the massive amounts of ground troops that would be necessary to squash the Hezbollah in South Lebanon. Finally, and then within a matter of hours, they recalled the troops. Why? Because the Americans, Condoleezza and Bush, were on the phone to Omar, urging him to accept the terms of this outrageous ceasefire, a ceasefire that leaves our hostages remaining in the hands of the Hezbollah, that leaves the Hezbollah with all of their weapons, that leaves Syria and Iran in a position where they can continue to arm the Hezbollah. So what will happen here? Exactly what we predicted when we called upon Israel not to accept the ceasefire. What will happen here is that there will be international troops that are sympathetic to the Hezbollah. There will be troops of the Lebanese army, which is composed of a majority of sympathetic Hezbollah members and supporters. They are the ones that will protect Israel. It is unprecedented in Israeli history that Israel would plead and beg for such a ceasefire and would beg the international community to protect us. This is what has happened here. There were a lot of unprecedented things that happened in this war. And so we say that the IDF did win this war. It's obvious that the IDF could destroy Hezbollah. Yes, there were horrible problems logistically in this war. And those of you that are listening to the Israeli media and to the international press and stories about the war can see what happened. Of course, there were great failures here. But overall, the IDF won the war, and the soldiers were willing eager to continue the fight. I went to visit hospitals in northern Israel last week. We videoed our trip with Dov Shurin to visit the wounded soldiers and civilians in Slatin, in Haifa. Unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, we've been having technical difficulties with our broadcasting equipment, and so I'm not able to show you that footage at this time. But each and every soldier that we saw told us the same thing. We have the ability to crush the enemy. There were those that complained about the sick, immoral standards of the Israeli army that prefer enemy civilians that are harboring terrorists to the lives of our own soldiers. There were those that told us stories about how they were injured and how their friends were injured and killed. Jewish soldiers killed because they were given insane orders to go house to house, even when they knew those homes were suspicious homes that were harboring terrorists, so that the world would not blame Israel for killing innocent civilians. What kind of war is this? What kind of army is this? What kind of warped moral standards are these? There is not an army in the world that would fight a war allowing the enemy to hide in known houses and yet still send soldiers in to be killed to search for those terrorists in a pinpoint search for terrorists in a time of war in the suspicious home, harboring terrorists only in Israel. And many of the soldiers were killed, were murdered, not only by Hezbollah, but by Israeli politicians who forced these insane moral ethical code on our soldiers. And of course, many soldiers were killed because the army refused to send in the Air Force to strike first and to soften the areas up the way it needed to be done. And so we spoke to these soldiers, and the soldiers said, we were waiting, we were hesitating. We were standing static in the same position. They didn't give us our orders. We were ready weeks before to go in and crush the Hezbollah. And of course, the Hezbollah had a tremendous advantage because the IDF was so hesitant and standing in the same positions. And many of these soldiers told us, we want to go back to Lebanon. We want to finish the job. And there were demonstrations yesterday in Israel, some which hit the media and others which did not. Soldiers that are demanding a commission of inquiry and that are demanding to finish the work. There's no ceasefire here. And Israel breaks the ceasefire to send Sayeret Matkal in. I'm sure you heard the news a few days ago. An officer in Sayeret Matkal was killed. 100 of Israel's most elite forces from the Commando Matkal unit went deep into Lebanon. And why did they go? Did they go there to kill Nasrallah? Did they go there to kill Hezbollah soldiers? Did they go there to crush Syrians who are smuggling in weapons once again to rearm the Hezbollah? No, they went there to get documents. To get documents that prove that that Syria and Iran are in fact continuing to arm the Hezbollah with Russian weapons. Now they're going to go cry, they're crying at the United Nations, send us more troops, and send troops with teeth that will enforce the embargo, as if we can expect the Goyim to do that which the Jews did not even do in this war. As if we can expect the world that stood idly by while 6 million Jews were being butchered to come and do that which is necessary to protect Jews, putting our faith in the nations of the world? Have we gone mad? We could have won this war in 6 hours had we had faith in God and unleashed the full force of the IDF to do that which needed to be done here. And what needed to be done here was to seize the land and not to retreat and run away from Lebanon. That was the problem in the first place. Why was Hezbollah in a position where they threatened major cities throughout northern Israel? They were in that position because Barak, the military genius that he is not, made a unilateral withdrawal from Lebanon 6 years ago, and the Hezbollah under our noses built an unbelievably strong infrastructure with the help of Iranian commandos and sophisticated intelligence. They built bunkers and brought in missiles that are a strategic threat to Israel. That's the core of the problem. And so obviously the answer lies in controlling that area and not once again allowing the Lebanese army, even if they had the power to rein in the Hezbollah, they have no desire to do so. And the German troops and Islamic troops from God knows where, Muslim countries that they're trying to get to join this so-called fighting force. They're the ones that are going to protect Israel. They'll do what they have always been doing in Lebanon and elsewhere, and that's standing idly by or actively helping our enemies to destroy us. And Israel will have to go in again, but this time they will have to crash through thousands of international troops that will be protecting the Hezbollah when Israel needs to do what is done. I mean, who are they blaming for breaking the ceasefire? Israel. In spite of all these wonderful documents that Israel seized in their recent raid that proves that the embargo is not being enforced, that proves that Syria and Lebanon are continuing to arm the Hezbollah with weapons that can kill innocent Jews. What are they bringing those missiles and rockets into Lebanon for? To kill Jews. Iran openly says repeatedly, we will destroy Israel. Israel has no right to exist. And they are building a nuclear arsenal that will be able to destroy Israel tomorrow. Of course we have to go into Lebanon. We have to stay in Lebanon. And we have to create a security zone. And we're already speaking about the flaws of the war. And we're already speaking about a commission of inquiry. And this is already in the consensus. So let's speak about the answers so that we do not have to make another commission of inquiry tomorrow after repeated failure or after, God forbid, Iran succeeds in destroying Israel or a significant part of Israel when they succeed in achieving the completion of building weapons of mass destruction that they launch against Israel as they promised to do. Let us not wait until the tragedy. Let us do now what needs to be done. Let us learn from the mistakes of this war. And the mistakes are you don't leave territory from which the enemy will once again utilize to kill Jews, especially if it is part of biblical Eretz Israel. I'm not saying that we need to launch a war to gain every part of what is biblical Eretz Israel. But certainly if the Arabs use those lands to attack us, we need to seize those lands and stay in those lands and annex those lands and allow unlimited Jews to settle there. We have to erase from our memories any notion of God forbid surrendering more land to the Arabs. And the minister, the forehead of the Shin Bet, the minister in the current Israeli government, is speaking about surrendering the Golan Heights for what? So that the Syrians can launch rockets on Tiberias tomorrow? Have we gone mad? And so, a commission of inquiry, that's fine. But let's start from 6 years ago, from the core of the problem. Let's talk about last year when we surrendered Gush Katif, and about the second Lebanon that we are building in Gaza now. Let's talk about preventing a second Lebanon in Judea and Samaria and the Golan Heights. Let's talk about retaking, liberating Gaza and Judea and Samaria and southern Lebanon and doing that which needs to be done to protect Israel. World opinion, the United Nations, who gives a damn what they think? If we've learned one thing from the Holocaust and from our blood-stained history, world history, Jewish history, is that we can rely only upon fellow Jews and upon the God of Israel for our salvation. You want to know what needs to be done? We need to strike Iran now. In a preemptive strike before Iran destroys Israel. We need to attack the supply lines and Syria if they are arming the Hezbollah. We need to retake Lebanon, southern Lebanon, quickly, swiftly, without having any mercy on the enemy and on the enemy civilian population that harbors the terrorists. We need to retake Gaza. We need to annex these areas. We need to stand tall and proud and do that which we are halakhically commanded to do and that which is common sense that any normal nation would do to survive. And, of course, this is something that will happen. I'd like to give a message here to Nasrallah because we received some emails from some Hezbollah supporters in Lebanon. And so, obviously, you are listening to our broadcast. Tell Nasrallah from whatever sewer he is currently hiding in, the brave Islamic warrior. So he sends his troops out to be massacred by Israelis. Yes, where is Nasrallah? Stinky Nasrallah in a stinky sewer. Or perhaps he's hiding in a bunker under the Iranian embassy. There will come a day, Nasrallah, and that day will come soon, when we will send you to Allah. Yes, Nasrallah to Allah, very, very soon. Because the generals in Israel and the soldiers are not happy. They are courageous, they are capable, and they have faith in the justice of our cause in spite of our weak leaders. These leaders will come and they will go. But soon there will be a true Jewish leadership in Israel that has faith in God. And you don't stand a chance. You will stay in that sewer for the rest of your life until we find you. And we will destroy you and your Hezbollah and your patrons in Iran and in Damascus. That is the Jewish way. And it's only a question of time before the generals and the fighters and the population of Israel, and as you can hear, they're upset with this war and they want to fight. They want to finish you off, and we will, God willing, soon destroy you, your Hezbollah, and your handlers in Damascus and in Tehran. Until then, tune in next week for our next Voice of Judea Television. And I once again apologize for the quality. If you want to help sponsor us so we can upgrade our equipment and so that we can upgrade our shows, please feel free to do so by sending a generous contribution to Voice of Judea Television, P.O. Box 6592, Jerusalem. That's VOJTV, P.O. Box 6592, Jerusalem. Help us upgrade the show. Help us get this message out to more Jews and to more Arabs around the world, because the God of Israel will not sleep and will not slumber, and we will come to get you, Nasrallah. Help sponsor this show and help sponsor our activities so that this will not merely be a dream, but a reality, Nasrallah's nightmare. Until next week, Shalom Aleichem.